Hello, welcome to Casio Graphing Calculators, and today we're going to be looking at the statistics menu in the fx-9750G3, the newest graphing calculator in Casio's line. What I'm doing today is showing you how to set up lists, how to do some calculations with lists, how to graph from a list, so statistical plots. So we're going into the stat menu, and what I'm doing here is on the 9750G3, but it's any Casio graphing calculator, you can do the exact same process. The main difference being it might be in a different location on the menu icon menu here because of the model that you might have. So we're gonna go into statistics, and I'm using a problem here to help illustrate. So this is an activity that comes from our Fostering Algebraic Thinking with Casio Technology. You'll notice it has activities, got some great questions where students are gonna take the situation and try to make tables, multiple representations, so tables and graphs, and answer some questions. But then the activity itself also has some sample answers, sample responses, and some calculator shots. So you'll see it kind of goes through the process, the steps, and these steps work on whatever graphing calculator you have from Casio. So let's go back here. Students are given information. We have, they're given 300 feet of fencing. They're gonna try to make a pen, rectangular pen, as large as possible for dogs, and they don't all agree on what dimensions it should be. So basically they're using the width and length of a rectangular enclosed area and a limited amount of fencing to decide which one has the largest area. So they're basically looking at width, length, and area, and perimeter as well. And so first question here is, what's the perimeter of the pen? Well, they have 300 feet of fencing that they have to use all of it. And no matter what size pen they use, this would be 300 feet, right? Because they have to use all of the pen. So we're really interested in, what do you do to figure out what's the length and width that a pen needs to be that has the largest area? So we're going to look at all of them. So we're going to go into the stat menu. So you'll see here's my menu on my calculator. I want the stat, which is either number 2, or I can use my navigation button here to arrow over, hit execute, enter. So here's where I can enter my lists. So the first thing I want to show you is, how do you put titles or labels in other than just list 1? So you'll see this sub row, and this is where I can enter text. And to do that, I'm going to use the alpha key. And so let's say we're going to put the first column is going to be our widths. So I'm choosing alphabet. In fact, I'm going to do shift alpha so that it's locked. And I'm going to now write the word width. So W. So you'll notice that the letters are above in red the button. So anytime you see in above and in red, that is where your finding your text thing. So I'm done. I hit execute when I finished. And so now you'll see that that's there. And now let's go over to list 2. List 2 we're going to do as the length. So again, I do shift alpha to lock the alphabet so I don't have to keep going back. And we're going to do L, E, and I'm just looking for the letters above the buttons that are in red, and that will give me my text. And execute to enter. And the last one we are interested in, how do each of those widths and lengths include to our area? So our last one's going to be area. So A, R, E, A. All right, so that's how you enter labels into your lists, into your columns. And now we want to enter our numbers. So I could enter by hand, so I can start with a width of 0, what would the length have to be, or I could use some calculations. So we're gonna do that by thinking about this. If this is a rectangular prism, what do we know? I mean, a rectangular area, we know that a rectangle has a width and a length, and it has two widths, opposite sides that are the width are the same, and it has two lengths that are also the same. So really, if I know that width and length make up the 300 feet of perimeter, and half of that is one width and one length, I know that a width and a length together have to add up to 150. So if I have a width of 0, it means I have a length, I'm just going to do this, of 150. Now, realistically, these are kind of discussions you would have with students. That makes no sense to have a zero width, because really then you just have a long line of 150 of two fences with 150 length, no closing at the end there because there's zero, so that there really isn't in that area. But these are the possibilities, and that's all we're looking for, is what are the possible widths and lengths with 300 feet total that we have to use, and it has to be a rectangle. So now I could do, okay, so what if it's one? And you can also talk to students, do we want decimal values? Can you do half of a foot or a quarter of a foot? We're going to just focus right now on whole number feet. So I'm going to go over here. Instead of typing them in by hand, this is where we can use our statistical ability to make calculations and fill in our column without having to enter by hand. So notice I've gone up to list one. I've gone up to where it says list one. This means whatever I do up here is going to fill in that entire column based on that. So what I want to then do is, I need to hit exit because I want to go to options. Sorry, I was hitting. Options always means, so for those of you not familiar with Casio calculators, you have your menus here and here's all the things you can do. But if you hit option, that gives you more things that you can do. So I want to go into list and I want to make a sequence. I want to basically come up with a sequence to fill this in. And what do I know? I know that my width, we're using whole numbers, is going to go up by one every single time. And I'm going to stop when I get to 150 for the width, because the largest width I can have is 150. So that's a sequence. So I'm going to hit sequence and it's asking me for some input. And basically I'm going to tell it, okay, we're talking about the value of X. Our equation is just X. And we're looking at the variable X. So these first two have to do with equation. What equation are you doing? And what's the variable we're focused on? And then the next number that you enter is, what's the start value? So we know we're starting at zero. Next number. So notice I'm putting a comma between each kind of constraint. I know I'm going to stop at 150. And the last thing you enter is, what is your step? How are you going? How are you adding, subtracting, multiplying, whatever. We are going to be adding one, so I'm going up by one. Now, if I wanted to use decimals, maybe I wanted to do half a foot, I could have put 0.5, but we're going to just go by one for the sake of this. So I'm going to close my parentheses and I'm going to hit execute. And what that's done, because I'm up here in list, it's going to fill in the entire list doing this sequence, starting at zero until it gets to 150, adding one each time. So we're going to hit execute, and so you can see, I'm not going to go all the way down, but you can see that it's basically added and has gone all the way to 150, so I didn't have to enter those by hand. So let's do the same thing over here for list two. So what is list two? Well, we know that list two is related to list one, and it's, if list one has a value of zero, I know together they have to make 150, so list two is 150. If list one is one, then list 2 is 150 minus 1, and that makes 149. So list 2 is basically 150 subtracting out every value of list 1 as you get to it. So here we're just going to do an actual calculation. We're going to just do list 2 is 150, subtract out all the value, the corresponding value in list 1. Well, I have to get that word list in here, so watch how I do that. I hit exit, and there's list. So I'm going to hit F1. Oops. Let's hit exit again. Let's try this again. 150. I hit exit. I hit list. Damn it. All right, so I'm going to start with my subtraction. So 150. I want to subtract, and I need to get that list number in there. So I hit option, and I hit list, F1. And I hit list again because I want that word list in there. And now I type in the list that I want to subtract from 150. So I want list 1 to be subtracted from that list. So I hit execute, and now you'll notice that what it's done, because I used a formula basically for all of list 2, it's taken whatever, taken 150 and subtracted whatever value in list 1 is at that corresponding list 2 value. So now I've got the width and the length. And so one thing you could do is maybe do a comparison, see what the graph looks like this. You know, as the width increases, what's happening to the length? Can that help us determine what the largest area is? So let's just do a real quick show you how to do the graph. So I'm going to get back, hit exit until I see graph as an option. F1 to hit graph. First thing I want to do is set up my graph. So graph one, that's what we want. We want a scatter plot. And list one would be our width, let's remember. And list two is our length. So that looks good for me. And we want to then hit exit. It's set up fine. Let's make sure it's on. Graph's on. So let's actually see what that graph looks like. And so as you can see, this is as width is the x value. So as width is increasing, our length is decreasing. We could even do shift trace F1 and kind of use our navigation thing to go through. And so we can see all the different corresponding pairs. So x is width and length. And so this is just showing us what the different widths and lengths are. So these are different rectangular examples of a fence. And now it's, so we haven't really actually answered what is the maximum area. Now students could do a calculation here with these numbers. They can look at the pairs. They could go back to their table and look at the pairs and do some calculations. But here's where, again, we want to use our statistics menu. So let's actually calculate the area. So as we calculate the area, we are going to do another equation. So what is the area of a rectangle if we know the width and the length? Well, it's width times length. So this would be list one times list two. So let's hit exit till we see list again. Or I'm sorry, option. So there's list. And we want to do list one times, and then let's hit option again. List two. So this is now, notice, because I'm up here in list three, the title of the column, it's going to fill in all of those values, taking every list one, multiplying it by every list two. So we're going to hit execute, and here are our different area values. So you'll see it makes sense that they're going up, and students have probably already figured out that they probably need larger numbers, and they can figure out, you know, where is it kind of reaching a maximum. We haven't quite reached a maximum yet. So they could scroll through and look and start noticing where the numbers are going back down again. And so maybe this might take quite a while. So is there a faster way? So it looks like we're starting to go back down about here, right here. So somewhere between 79 and 80, we're going back down. So what does that look like if we graph it? So let's again hit exit till we get to a graph, F1. Let's set up a second graph. So the second graph, let's make it, so you notice here are my choices. We already know something's in graph one. Let's go to graph two. And let's do another scatter plot, but we want it to be list one, or it could be list two, but we want the area in there. So let's do list one compared to list three this time. So let's change the list. We want it to be three. And let's hit exit. Let's turn that graph on. Let's turn the first graph off so that we only see one at a time. And then let's turn this graph on. So notice I'm turning it on by clicking F1. And let's draw it and see what it looks like. So notice that now it's showing me as the width increases, here it's being multiplied by length, and here is the areas. And so you can see that the areas are going up, then they reach a peak, and then they come back down. So students, the question is, what's the maximum area? So they can kind of see that it's in here somewhere. So they can do G solve, they can do trace. You know, if we do trace, we can kind of get an approximation of where we think it is. We know that it was around somewhere here, and we're only using whole numbers, so is that the exact thing? So just different ways to help them explore and figure this out. So that's how you use the stats menu. I'm going to hit exit so you can go back. So we've got our tables, we've got our graphs, we've got our calculations that we used, and you can always arrow up. Well, we went way down. So this is how you use the statistics menu in the graphing calculator for Casio. I'm using a fx-9750G3, the newest graphing calculator, but this will work in all of Casio's graphing calculators.